Sunday. different attitude. It's a different energy. You know, and then what I love is the fact that there are new people that are engaging this for the first time. I don't know how long you've been saved. You know, sometimes you've been saved a while, but you finally get it. You finally get to the place where you come into. And what God is doing in the lives of His people is absolutely phenomenal. I want to thank you for your prayers for my brother Dwayne. He has gone through a very extensive and five, maybe six-hour surgery. He is in tremendous pain. Talked with him again as I was driving here to church and shared with him. I was just glad that I was able to pour in to him. You know, when your body is down, somebody needs to meet your spirit. Hallelujah. And I just wanted to share with him that this pain is, it hurts, but this is good pain. Matter of fact, I even posted it. That pain is indeterminable. You know, pain just hurts. And my wife says, there's a pain that hurts and keeps damaging and destroying. And then there's a pain that won't last too long, but it's going to heal. And so you've got to know, but at times that pain feels the same. You don't know whether this is hurt pain or healing pain. So you've got to speak the word over your life. Thank God. I meant to get to this Sunday, but the Holy Ghost swept through this place. And we thank God for Elder Elliott. And we bless the Lord for him. A fine man of God. And for his wife. We bless the Lord for God's brought him through. I'm going to give you some details a little later, but I want to share with you that our own Sister Curtis Bass, for our newcomers that may not know Sister Curtis, she's usually the constant voice of our greater report. She's the head of our creative services ministry, part of a bunch of different factions, but last night her father passed away. She was in Memphis on Friday, Saturday, I believe. The weekend came, had a phenomenal time in the worship experience, and her last night her father passed away. And so we're asking. wonderful and they're loquacious and they're verbose and all the rest of this stuff. But, you know, that's not how you pray. You ought to pray like you talk. Because prayer really is that conversation with God. It is you communicating. And don't, you know, don't worry because you can't modulate, you can't shift keys in the prayer. I can't do that either. Amen. No, I'm just being honest. Some people have that gift, and it sounds beautiful, but trust me, they look around in the shade and donate. I love that. Matter of fact, I wish I could squall, so that's why I bring in people to squall. Amen. How is your, this is part of my culture. You know, everybody can't jump either. Right, watch. Okay. So my point is, that we don't all have the same gifting. And it's okay. However you pray. However you believe God, you know, that's what we're going to do. So we're not going to be intimidated to pray. Because the enemy doesn't want you to pray. Because he realizes that if you ever learn how to talk to God for yourself, that he is in trouble. That he can't speak to you because you keep talking to God. And God keeps speaking back to you through his word. Are we here? Prayer is the official language of the kingdom of God. I'm just trying to catch people up there with us. I talked about misplacing and losing my Bluetooth, right? And I went back to the tailor and asked him, I said, hey, you see my Bluetooth? He said, no, you need Bluetooth? I said, no, Bluetooth. No, Bluetooth. And so what happens is we get lost in translation because I'm saying one thing and he thinks I'm saying something else. The same thing happens in your prayer language. When you are talking out of fear, God is not listening to your fear, and God is not, watch this, moved by your emotion. Now, I know it's a romantic thing to suggest that the Lord, you know, he bottles my tears, and I understand where we pull that from Scripture out of context, but we pull it anyway, and we say stuff that's not appropriate, but, you know, it fits for our conversation. But God is not moved by your emotion. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, but without what? Faith. It is what? Impossible to do what? Please God, for he that what? Come to God must believe that he is. And that he is a reward of them that diligently seek. Ooh, look at y'all reading the Bible. That's what I'm talking about. So it is faith that moves God. Right? And so it is not praying in anxiety. Because it tells us to be anxious for nothing but by
prayer.
With let your be made. Yeah, so we're not to pray anxiously. We're not to come scared. We're not to come overwhelmed. We come boldly before the throne of grace. Amen. We come boldly. Why? Because we have a right to be here. Can I say that you have a right to be in the presence of God? Had not Jesus Christ died for our sins, we have no right. Well, it says not only do we have a right, we have an invitation. He is constantly inviting us to be in his presence, to know his name, to hear his heart. And so that's what we have. So we have a right, we got an invitation, and we come boldly before the throne of grace. And we're not intimidated because we don't come with the same language of others. We come with our native tongue. And maybe your prayer is this, Lord, help me. Maybe your prayers, you don't know what, you can't even utter it. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, likewise, the Spirit helpeth our infirmities, our weaknesses. Because we don't know how to pray as we ought. But he that knoweth the mind of the Spirit maketh intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. That's when you're not up hearing the older saints just groaning in prayer. Sometimes prayer was very loud and it was a whole lot of people crying out. So, and then sometimes prayer was just real quiet and they would just groan. And so I says, and the Lord knows the other. Sometimes it's just, oh Lord, oh, that's all you can do. But God knows the oh. He knows how to decipher that prayer that is coming that has no articulation of speech. It has no qualifying word. It is gibberish to somebody that's listening. But because God is God, he deciphers the oh. He knows the oh. And then sometimes that's all you can say is, oh Lord, oh God, oh Jesus. Because there are no words for your pain. There's no words for your uncertainty. There's no words for your condition. I'm hoping that after we get finished teaching for these couple of weeks, that you will understand that it is almost impossible for you to pray if you do not know the Word. Because at the end of the day, watch this, we got to pray His Word back to Him. We got to give Him His Word back. And watch this, when you start praying the Word of God back to God, it gives you the confidence that He knows that you know what you're talking about. And He understands because He says He watches over His Word to perform it. Hallelujah. And then Jesus says in John, He says, if ye abide in me and my Word, come on, abide in you, you shall ask what you will. He says, just let the Word abide in you. And watch this, you can ask what you will. And when the Word is abiding in you, you won't ask for yourself. You will ask the will of God. You will pray according to the will of God. You won't waste God's time on cell phones and cable bills and cars and houses and people liking you. That just makes no sense. He's giving you dominion over all that. You're praying about that sometimes we're just wasting good prayer time over stuff that God has already given us power over. I got Bible for it. He's given us what? Dominion. Is that what the Bible says? He's given us dominion. I can walk you through scripture to even show you that the dominion that God gave us, He never took away. Ooh, God. The same dominion that He gave Adam, He did not take it away. Come on. Let me just take you quickly through the Old Testament. He gave Adam dominion. He kicked him out the garden. He gave him an eviction plan, right? He terminated his lease. But he still had dominion. And even after Adam had children, and the children of men, they grew up, and God got sick of them somewhere around Genesis chapter 8, and He said, I'm going to destroy the earth, right? I'm tired of this. And so He grabs Noah, right? Noah grabs his family. Noah preaches, tell them, go on in the ark. It's going to rain. They don't believe it. It rains. They drown. God starts all over with Noah. But notice this. He starts all over, but he never took the dominion that He gave Adam. He never took it away. Noah had it too. God here. So watch this. If He didn't take it from Adam, didn't take it from Noah, and He watched this, He didn't take it from Jesus, He didn't take dominion from you. You've got, come on here. And now that you have the Holy Ghost, the Bible says, greater is He that is, come on, in me than he that is in the world. In the world. So you have the power of the living God inside of you. And there's some things, because you have dominion, that you don't even need to pray about. What would you be, Pastor? Don't pray. No, I'm just trying to say you got dominion over some stuff. Yeah. So you don't have to spend time praying about the things you got dominion over. Yeah. That's like me praying for a house and I own it. Yeah. I'm limited. What in the world are you praying for the house for? Yeah. Then you already have that. Right. You got dominion. Right. And so when we talked last week that we pray to God and we do what? Speak to things. Yeah. We got Bible for it. Jesus keeps speaking to things. He speaks to things. He prays, and then He speaks to things. He speaks to demons and devils. He speaks to the wind and the waves. Is that what it is? Jesus was asleep. They wake Him up. He gets up, and He does what? He rebukes the wind and the wave and says, peace be still. So Jesus gives us this pattern on how to speak to things. Remember I told you last week, I speak to barking species. Hallelujah. You got to practice on something. You know, just start with parking space before you go to demons. Amen. Oh, to parking space. If you can't command the parking space to be open, don't be chasing after no devil. Amen. You're going to be like the seven sons of Sceva. He won't get out on you and leave you wounded and embarrassed. And we're going to look at you and say, you know, Mason, I know. And Jesus, I know. But who are you? Right? So let's start off with some small parking spaces. So we prayer can be frustrating if you don't understand God's word. So we talk about six types of prayer. The prayer of agreement, which we're going to deal with tonight in Matthew 18 to 19, is the prayer of faith or the prayer of position. It is the prayer of consecration. It is the prayer of praise and worship. And notice that on Sunday, remember I said, because the Lord allowed Elder Rashard waves of glory. That's why you can't be rushing God. It's waves of glory. Just sit, wait, and see where you're going to move next. And when he's done, we done. Amen. When he's done, we done. So we just want to get in the glory. Amen. And so when he was just exhorting and beginning to bless God, that was the prayer of praise and worship. We already did the prayer of binding and loosing. Amen. We did the prayer of petition, you know, that whole thing. We did the prayer of consecration. I just want y'all to see what happened Sunday. We teach this on Wednesday, and all of a sudden the Holy Ghost blow through this place, and he's showing us this stuff. What was the prayer of consecration? Now, we already did intercessory prayer, because they came down, we prayed for specific needs, right? We did binding and loosing, right? We heard the prayer of praise and worship, right? But the prayer of consecration is when the Lord spoke to me with the Holy Ghost. I sense the Holy Ghost leading me to say that you got to say yes to God.
Yes.
That's the prayer of consecration. Jesus prays this prayer of consecration in the Garden of Gethsemane. He says, Lord, if there's any way that you can, that this thing can pass from me. He says, nevertheless, not my own. But yes, see, the prayer of consecration is the yes, Lord. And then watch this, a properly placed yes, Lord. Is a bookmark in the heart of God. It's a bookmark in the heart. When you say yes, it's a bookmark in the heart of God. God will just flip right back to that page where you said yes. Where you gave him your will. Where you turned everything over to him. Alright? And so, we're going to talk about prayer agreement. Notice this passage. And I have in your handout the Message translation. Read from the English Standard Version of the iPad. But I want you to hear the Message translation. Take this most seriously. A yes on earth is a yes in heaven. Stop. A yes on earth is a what?
A yes in heaven.
A yes on where?
Earth.
Is a yes in
heaven.
Okay. So, he says, whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Now, this is very important that you get this. A yes on earth is a yes in heaven. A no on earth is a what?
No.
A no in heaven. What you say to one another is eternal. I mean this. When two of you get together on anything at all on earth and make a prayer of it, my Father in heaven goes into action. And when two or three of you are gathered together because of me, you can be sure that I'll be there. That's the Message translation. Now, you can read it out of your own translations, King James, whatever you got. Let me give this to you from the English Standard Version. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, this is very important. How many of you in your translations have that word again in there? Raise your hands, I want to see it. You see the word again? This phrase is critical, and I'm going to show you why in a second. If you got again in your translation, because it's not in the Message translation, right? Yes, okay. The again in the Message translation is and. Okay? Connecting these two thoughts. So it's a continuous thought, right? Connecting. This is important. You ready for this? Because the prayer of agreement cannot be prayed unless the prayer of binding and loosing proceeds. See, Jesus is not teaching two different types of prayer. He is teaching that the prayer of agreement flows out of the prayer of binding and loosing. I guess you didn't in a minute. I want you to read. Notice what he says. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about what? Anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. So these six types of prayers that we take binding and loosing, and we take the prayer of agreement, and we integrate them, we connect them together, because they're connected with the word again and the word and.
Yeah.
So let me show you how this goes. He says, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Now, I want you to get the backstory to this. Jesus is talking to them as a rabbinical Jew. And he's basically saying that there is a protocol that happens up in heaven.
Amen.
He says there's a way that heaven operates. And this is what he said. Now, you've got to remember, before we get to chapter 18, Jesus! said, you know what I was waiting for? He needed a prophet. Thank you, man. These are Poindexter's keys. He got a lot of authority. Look at this. No. Thank you for this. Watch this. Y'all ready for this? Every key represents a door. And so he got so many keys that it suggests that he can go through a lot of doors. That's going to take him some time to figure out which key, because these ain't labeled. And I'm sure that he's standing in front of a whole lot of doors waiting to see if they can hold on. And then he gets happy about it. And no, no, don't worry about it. I got a key. I got a key. And watch this. Not only does he have a key, he's got 1, 2, 3, 4. He's got 4 rings connected to a main ring with keys on them that says this is the amount of authority that he has. And you look at this and go, oh, that's just Deacon Poindexter. But you don't know that brother got keys. Okay, then that's who he was doing. Oh, that's just Deacon Poindexter. He don't talk much. He got keys. And when you got keys, you ain't got a lot to say. Because you cannot walk where everyone, everybody else is talking. You opening up doors. You doing new stuff that blocks everybody else. While you talking, he's opening. No fellowship, no connection. share my burden. So maybe I need to find someone who is in a similar situation and say, I need you to touch and agree with me. Because when we touch and agree, I don't have to explain the problem. You're already living in it. So they grab my hands and say, in the name of Jesus, I agree for the deliverance of this child. If your heart has never been broken, if your spirit has never been trampled upon, if you've never gone through sickness and disease, if you've never been put out, if you've never gone through anything, you can't agree with me on this.
So that they can
nothing to work with. So bring the other person, and they say, well, I'm just believing the Lord for my child. What about your child? I'm not trying to get in your business. But if you come up here for me to pray on your behalf, do y'all see where we're messing up here? We're asking people to pray for us, but they ain't got nothing. And I know the Lord knows. Then if that's the case, you'll be staying in your seat. Because God knows. I'm not being funny or I'm being serious. Because God knows. You only come up here to say that I want you to pray for me. I want you to intercede for me. I want you to agree with me. And so I have to know what we're agreeing to. I've got an interview Monday at 4:30. And it's at, give me an address somewhere in Atlanta. And I'm meeting with Mr. Jones. And I'm believing that God at 4:45 is going to touch his heart to give me this job. Then I say, because I've been unemployed. Because I've gone from job to job. I stand in agreement that on Monday at 4:45, Father, we bind every interfering demon. We bind every disruption. We bind every distraction. And we loose favor upon that person at 4:45 with Mr. Jones for this job. And when you pray like that, Jesus says, hold on, let me get some of that. Jesus said, let me get some of that. Let me get some of that. I stand in agreement with what they said. Because out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. We gotta go. Prayer, watch this. A prayer can never override another's will. So if you're not willing, then my prayer for you, God's not going to override your will. That's why I ask people, what are we praying for? When they come up here, I'm just saying, so what are we praying for? What are we believing God for? Because if you're not believing, and I'm doing all the believing, it's going to be a short prayer. Amen. I'm just being honest. You see, we play with people too much. And you know what we do? We play the game of church. Yeah. We try to get spiritual all deep, like, am I anointing? And I'm sorry, I know I'm stepping on some toes, some cultural toes, but I grew up with that. My anointing is on you. I see evangelists and people run the Bible. I take my anointing and I put it on. You can't do that. What kind of mess is that? But it's great theater.
You are one, right? There are no long ranges within the
God, Jesus designed the kingdom to work in partnership with the Father and with one another. Choose your prayer partner wisely. I said wisely. We run around and talk about this, my prayer partner, like this is your best friend. And sometimes your best friend should be your prayer partner. I'm just being honest. Because watch this. Sometimes what they know about you can block them believing for you. Including family members. Family members tell you to pray for you all the time. And they do that out of just because we family. But you need somebody who just simply don't know your idiosyncrasies. They don't know, they don't know your mood swings. But they're praying for you. That your soul is so important that there is a connection to the Holy Ghost. And they themselves are demonstrating walking out a prayer life. Choose your prayer partner wisely. One can't agree with something that they don't have faith in. If there's no agreement, then faith alone cannot produce the prayer. I want you to flip over because I want to give this to you. So we close. The process of the prayer agreement. So we talked about it already. We bind all improper things that do not coincide with the Word of God. So if we're going to pray, then let's start binding things that are not of God. I talked about last week, sanctifying atmosphere, right? So we just bind everything. Come on, let's practice. Father, we just bind everything that's not like you. God, we clear our mind. We bind every thought. We bind every negative word. We bind every negative confession. We bind every negative emotion. We bind every spirit that is of the devil that brings disruption and division. Father, we lay hold to your word. We bind it in our home. We bind it in our car. We bind it in our mate. We bind it in our children. We take authority over our places of worship, over our job. Come on, open your mouth. We bind the devil. And now, Lord, we loose your favor. We loose the peace of God in our life. We loose the provision of God in our life. We loose the favor of God in our life. We believe you for favor. We trust you because of your word. And we thank you that you watch over your word to perform it. Hallelujah. So we bind. We loose the third one. You choose someone with the same level of faith to believe for that specific thing the way you are believing, saying, speaking, and acting in the same manner. Because the prayer of agreement is not just saying it. It's believing it, it's speaking it, and it's walking it out in the same manner. And if you want to be the prayer partner, if you want to pray in the prayer of agreement, then you got to say it. Because we've been praying on the prayer call. I've been making these calls about this woman with this medical supply that needed the medical bed, the air mattress, and the lift system. And so I got a text that one of the people on the prayer call at 7 o'clock in the morning in California, listen to this, in California. So she's got to get on the prayer call at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
Right. The problem is, you know, when we got to start moving it, we take each other for granted so much that we don't even believe the stuff that we're doing. Somebody in California is on the prayer call at 4 o'clock in the morning. And then they sent word to this church asking, did the person get the bed? Because if they didn't, then they got a bed that they can get to them, right? Then they got a hospital bed. And so once we figured it out, I want you to get this, once we figured it out, the transport and hospital bed from California to New York, because that's when we find out the person who needs it is in New York. Because there are 15 states represented on the prayer call. So we got to figure out what state we're talking about. But here's where I got encouraged. I said, we thank you for at least having the unction to want to help. Right? And then what the Lord helped me to understand was that we put it out in the atmosphere. Oh, God. Come on, y'all. I saw it as when, what's his name, Elijah was praying for rain. And he said, I see the cloud the size of a man's hand. Just because someone was willing to send it from California, then my prayer increased and said, Lord, then give me somebody in New York. Give me somebody in Georgia. Give me somebody in Maryland. Give me somebody in Connecticut that has a connection to the person in New York that can pick up a phone and call a medical facility or whatever, supply office, and get this to this woman. Because I'm not going to stop praying until she gets it. Can I help you with something? That's right. Push. But let me help you with something with agreement. When you pray the prayer of agreement, you can't settle for something else. Come on, y'all. He's the God Almighty. He can do anything. Come on, say it. He can do anything. So watch this. Be specific. Number five. Be specific. Be as detailed as possible. Sorry, I messed that up. Be specific and as detailed as possible. Okay? Be specific and as detailed as possible. Father, I thank you for 2015. Fill in the blanks. BMW. Say it. Fill in the blanks. Whatever that thing is, but be as what? As possible, right? Agree one time and do not repeat the prayer. Move on to the prayer of praise and worship. Agree one time and then do what? Where? What's your Bible reference for? You don't have to cite the scripture, but tell me the story. I did this last Tuesday. Come on, I mean last Wednesday. Lazarus. Jesus gets to the grave and says, Father, I that you already heard. He agreed that he was going to get him up.
Yes.
And then he moved on. Because praying the prayer of agreement over and over is vain repetition.
Yeah.
If you agree one time, move on to praise and worship. And just tell him, Father, I thank you that you heard. Because now you move, watch this, into expectation. You have already asked. Now you're living in expectation. Are we here? Agree with us. Okay, number seven. Only settle for what you were specific about. And here's, I want you to get this. It must work or Jesus is a liar. Kenneth Hagin Sr., who was a phenomenal teacher in faith in the Word. Kenneth Hagin said, and these are his words, that's why I gave him the quote. He made the point that he said, if the prayer agreement doesn't work, then Jesus is a liar. And how many of you know that God's not a man that he should, neither the son of man that he should. Come on, keep reading the word. That's Romans, no, that's Numbers 23:19. So watch this. Kenneth Hagin was preaching a revival. He said he was preaching a revival. He goes for weeks, and he prayed the prayer agreement with his wife. We've got the story show. He prayed the prayer agreement with his wife. He told his wife, he said, at 3 o'clock every day, open the Bible to Matthew chapter 18, verse 18, and put your finger on it. He says, wherever I am preaching, at 3 o'clock, I'm going to open the Bible, Matthew chapter 18, verse 18, and I'm going to put my finger on it. Because he's using the word where two or three are touching and agreeing. So he says, I'm going to put my finger on it. You put your finger at 3 o'clock. Notice they are what? Specific. And so he said, and we're going to agree that their revenue, that the money from the meeting is going to be this amount. He was in revival, they did the thing, come to the end of the revival, he didn't get the money. The pastor said, oh, we didn't get your stuff. So they go to some room and they dump out the money on the table. And then Kenneth, he says, the pastor says, here, you count this half, I'll count this half. And so they counted the halves, they wrote it on a piece of paper, this is how much I got, this is how much I got. So they put it together, and Ken Hagin said, this isn't going to work, because this isn't what we agreed upon. And the pastor said, well, we didn't agree. He said, no, not me and you, me and my wife. We agreed that God would do this amount, and that's not it. He says, well, if you agree, then let's do it again. So they counted the money again, and it came out the same number. They counted it again, it came out the same number. He says, well, this is not going to work. I can't go home. He says, what do you mean you can't go home? He says, because we agreed to this, and this is not it. So then he said, well, listen, let me count your pile, and you count my pile, because maybe we made a mistake. So they switched piles, and they counted the piles, and it came up with the same number. And Kenneth Hagin said, we got a problem. And he says, well, Brother Hagin, I don't know what you want to do. He said, well, I can't go home. And he said, now I got to go back to every church and tell the churches, don't believe that scripture that I've been preaching because Jesus is a liar. He says, it's just not going to happen. He says, no, well, let's count it again. They counted it again. I'm listening to this testimony, and I'm thinking, what's wrong with me? This is pastor's testimony. Saint Joe, this is my I have grown up in the church, and I have learned to live on the compromise of my prayers.
Yes, sir.
Because I haven't stuck it out to say I'm not moving until I get what I ask for. And then ruffles, potato chips, sour cream, and cheddar with a
miracles. It demonstrates power. It creates abundance. It brings freedom. It brings deliverance. And it escapes temptation.
So now, you give faith. On your road. Listen, we're not going to do it. We're going to break out into these prayer groups on our last prayer group. But let's practice this. Ask somebody, is this something specific I can agree with? On your road. And then I just want you to take a moment and start praying about that specific. Is this something specific? Now listen, no, if you're not comfortable with a person, don't give them nothing heavy. Give them a parking space. Give them a parking space. Don't give them more parking space. Something specific that I can believe God with you about. Something specific that I can pray into. Just go ahead and believe God. Go ahead. Just start praying about that stuff. You gotta, do this with something. You can't do it by yourself, y'all. You gotta get somebody. Something specific. Give them a parking space. Something lift your hands for an offering of the Lord. We miss you on Sunday. We don't want to miss you today. Your tithe and offerings of the Lord. To you that can and will tonight, will you just try to give a $10 gift? If you can't do that, just do something as close to it as possible. Share with somebody else and say, hey, listen, help me make this $10. I got four. You got three. That's seven. Turn around, look at somebody else and say, hey, we need $3. And make it $10. Just group the offering together. Amen? Listen, we're a family. You're going to have to learn. I'm trying to help some people. So I'm very careful who I go out to eat with. Because if you're at the table with me, then you've given me access to your plate. No, I'm just being honest. I'm just being honest. That's why don't go to that with me. I'm just being honest. And if you're funny like that, then you need to stay wherever you're at. Amen? That's where we grew up. You at the table? Oh no, that plate is everybody's. Hallelujah. Like I said, we ain't going to dinner, man. I got no props. I got a key for that. When you get that offering, you have. Beloved, will you listen to me tonight? If you are a man in this building and you have not text manhood to 313131, we need you to do that. We need you to do that this coming Friday at 7 o'clock at the Kingdom Center. Is a special presentation of the men's ministry. And we're asking you to please bring young men because we will have the Marietta Police Department with us. We've got some mentoring things that we're doing. We're going to walk our young men and our older men through some things. We need you to please text the word manhood in your this message place. And then where it says two, you want to just punch in 313131. That gives us the ability to get your cell phone and we will send you texts. Messages so that you'll know what we're doing. You'll know how to communicate. We keep in contact. This coming Friday, all roads lead to the Kingdom Center for the men's ministry. Amen. At 7 o'clock, we want you to be a part of what God is doing. In our last ministry, we had over 60-something men there. We've got 95 men already registered in the men's ministry. That's part of my goal this year. We are going to do this with men and with our sons and with our cousins and our nephews. And if you need a faith focus, we want to make sure that you're getting the faith focus. If you don't have the 90-day challenge prayer, 90-day greater transition journal, make sure that you raise your hands. We'll get that to you. Men's ministry is also going out on Friday the 30th. Join us for bowling. Please sign up and see any of the leaders for our men's ministry. Cattle will begin this Saturday at 8 a.m. This is just Cattle, not Cattle Advance. This is just Cattle. If you missed the class, this is the class you got to be in. Otherwise, we're going to close registration. It's a $25 fee. You can do that. Go on site on our website and make that payment or do it on Saturday. The Worship Arts Ministry, I'll be meeting with all of the Worship Arts Ministry on Thursday at 7 o'clock. That's tomorrow at 7 o'clock. There is a reorganization that I want to share with you, and so I want all of you here so that we can talk. This coming Sunday night is our call to worship. This Sunday night call to worship. I'm going to tell you this is a time when we come intentionally just to be in the presence of God through praise, prophetic word, and worship. Bring your prayer shawls. Bring the oil. We're going to go in again on Sunday night at 6 o'clock. The nursing home ministry will take place on the 17th, and then the jurisdictional department of evangelism will be already available on Monday. All right? The blessing of the Lord be upon you for Sister Curtis Bass. We're going to get this information. We're going to send it out in a calling post. But we want to let you know that visitation is this Saturday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. The homegoing service is going to be at 1 p.m. at Joe Ford Funeral Home. We're going to have to post this for some of you. It's the address is 1616 Winchester Road in Memphis. The burial will take place on Tuesday the 20th. And it's going to be at the Memphis National Cemetery. But I had something in my phone that said, in lieu of flowers, there was going to be donations made, I think, to the Lawson family. We'll figure out a way to get you the information. We'll make sure that we get that to you. Today, tomorrow. Would you just keep her in prayer? She's leaving early tomorrow morning to go to Memphis. And if you can't make it to Memphis, then make sure that you get a card, put something in it, write it, just leave it. You can leave it in our office. Jackie, can we just leave it in, slide under the door in your finances? sliding under the door. I'm serious, because you know what? She is a wonderful young woman. She's given herself to ministry, and so we want to make sure that as a church we're responding appropriately. All right? So we're going to do that. We're going to keep her in prayer. We ready to go? Okay, offering.
Follow the direction of the ushers and bring the Lord out.